Hey guys, Jordan with the Young Turks, TYT Politics. Sorry I'm a little late. We're working on Native American time here, so it's okay. I'm here in D.C. for the inauguration, going to be covering a lot of things, but first I want to cover an important story in relation to Standing Rock. And if you're not familiar, there's a young Native American woman, Red Fawn, who's been imprisoned for almost 3 months now for what I view as totally made-up charges. I'm here with her sister, Red Dawn, a second time we've spoken. And you're down here for the inauguration, talking about, obviously, the fight against the Dakota Access Pipeline, but more importantly, your sister. First, just tell me, how's your family been doing? Obviously, your sister's been in prison for October 27th was the date all this happened. So how's everyone doing?
Yes, she's been in prison since October 27th and just going over the holidays and everything. And her mother, Choylin Yellowwood, had passed away in June of this year. So this was the first holidays without Choylin. And So it's been very difficult not having Red Fawn here. It's been very, very difficult for the family. And this is the first holiday season without her mother, and just trying to continue to see positive. For us, it's been very difficult, and it's interesting because when we talk to her, she's kind of like the light of our hope and everything, and she's remained strong and positive throughout this whole process. So we'd like to be her rock, but it turns out that she is ours. And so
for those of you coming to this story totally new, don't know who Red Fawn is, don't know what happened, so obviously with the fight against the Dakota Access Pipeline, there's been a lot of arrests made. Not many of them have been legal or for actual crimes. A lot of them have just been treacherous oil police, as I like to call them. So on October 27th, there was an action near camp, and your sister, who was a leader in the camp, she was a medic and did a lot of different things. She was essentially, from the video, because I've watched the video many times, she was essentially pinned down. I count them like six or seven officers. So she was pinned down to the ground. I guess, I don't know, 10 to 15 seconds after being pinned down, you see, you hear and see kind of like, you know, two shots. It's not really, it's very difficult to even see where it's coming from. But what is not difficult to see is your sister's pinned down by seven people. So as I said in our last interview, either she is the female Rambo and was able to fire a gun with seven people on top of her, or she's being railroaded. She's been in jail, and recently there were more charges filed against her. I know that we're kind of blurry on all the details, but can you kind of talk about the new charges?
Yeah, so the charges on January 5th, she was charged with additional charges of felony acts of disorder, of firing a weapon during a civil disorder. And that has a minimum of 10 years in prison. And so they said that she could be possibly facing a minimum of 10 years to life. And I would like to also clarify, the state charges have not been dropped. They have been undocketed, meaning that the state can then pursue those charges at any time. So I know that there was a lot of public misconception that these charges were dropped, that presumably she was released, and
the attempted murder charge.
The attempted murder, yes. So, but those have not been dropped; they've been undocketed, and then can come back at any time. So, now we're looking at additional federal charges of in addition to her original federal charges of someone firing a weapon during a civil disorder. And this is very, very uncommon for someone to be charged this type of charges, but it's happening.
So the charges, there was an earlier charge, possession of a firearm by a convicted felon, and your sister Red Fawn pleaded not guilty to all firearm charges one day, and a 3-day trial has been scheduled for March 7th in Bismarck. So okay, for people just coming to this, like I said, if you look at Standing Rock over the last 4, 5, 6 months, there's a lot of different altercations, demonstrations, and most of them are, actually all of them, are aggressive by the police towards unarmed water protectors. They come, the water protectors, to pray. They come in the most aggressive case to try to slow down or shut down construction of the pipeline. But as far as I know, I have never seen, and I've been there five times, any water protectors holding a gun or anything other than signs or anything like that. So usually if you're charging someone with attempted murder or discharging a firearm in relation to a felony crime, you would provide a gun. You provide the gun. You'd show its fingerprints on the gun. Has, to your knowledge, the state or federal, because it's now a federal case, have they found a gun? Have they said we have her fingerprints? Anything like that?
So I haven't heard anything about fingerprints, but what I've been told is they have a weapon, but I don't have the details of that. Mm-hmm. So originally the narrative that was created is that she had, with her left hand, grabbed a officer's weapon and fired that. And so it's been systematically changing throughout. So I'm not sure what evidence we have right now. But again, the narrative has been changing from the beginning. So
the case on March 7th, that's going to be a 3-day trial. The trial is, to your knowledge, for attempted murder or illegal possession of a firearm?
It will be for firing a weapon during a civil disorderly event and a felony possession of a firearm.
So to the, and I encourage you, YouTube, you know, Red Fawn, arrest, you'll see what I'm talking about. She's buried on the ground with seven police officers on top of her. So either she has experience like at a Wild Wild West shootout where you could just like take somebody's gun like that, or something's not right here. Now, you've spoken with your sister, obviously, as best as you can, the lawyer. Your sister continues to say she's innocent and nobody's shown any proof otherwise. And like you say, they seem to be slippery, kind of changing charges. They've done that in a lot of cases in Standing Rock where, like, for example, Amy Goodman, that's the best case, Democracy Now! Originally, she was charged with trespassing. Then they tried to add on conspiracy, like holding a camera's a conspiracy. So this is a pattern where they don't even prove the first charge, and then they tack on other charges.
Yes. So it's really difficult to kind of keep up on exactly what they're charging her with. And we're getting information in a very short amount of time. Like, we didn't even know that she had a court date scheduled for January 5th. We found out, she was at court. Someone contacted us, and then thereafter. So just getting a clear grasp of exactly what she's being charged with, what the timeline looks like. We have March 7th, which is extremely close. I mean, to add additional charges and then set a trial date that soon, I mean, it definitely seems odd to me.
Now, I know there's certain things you can't talk about because you don't want to hurt your sister's case, but, you know, when I see, you know, the president, for example, just denied clemency to Leonard Peltier, a lot of people I've spoken with feel like this is running the risk of being the next Leonard Peltier. I'm not trying to scare you, but we should put it in context where they're almost like there's an epidemic of, you know, missing indigenous women, and almost like they're trying to put a face and trying to basically rationalize and prove their argument that these are armed, violent protesters. So they're trying to basically make your sister the face of that. What do you feel about that?
I absolutely agree. First of all, I'd like to say I am very sorry to the Peltier family. It was heartbreaking, extremely heartbreaking. I mean, I'm sitting here with a very heavy heart. I think that we had a lot of hope that he was going to be released, and it was pretty devastating to hear that. So I want to send my condolences to that family and just let them know our thoughts and prayers are with them.
And, Leonard Peltier, Native American leader, and has been in prison now for 40 years, and was up for basically being freed in his old age, and President Obama denied that.
Yes. So I definitely know that she was targeted, not just because of who she is as an individual, and also like just who our family is. We've been involved in the American Indian Movement for over 40 years. Our family was at the occupation of Alcatraz. So you just, it's easily to see why she would be as the individual targeted for this. She, her past history, how powerful and empowering she is on the camp. Everybody who's met her has said, you know, this is one of the first people I've met and she helped me out and she was really inspiring. So she was very powerful within the camp as well.
What I don't understand and the common person wouldn't understand is if somebody, you know, if somebody's arrested and charged with shooting at a police officer, that's one of the most serious crimes you could have. So most times they don't keep people in prison without some type of evidentiary preview or this is what we have. And you and your family have not been told anything. You don't have, you know, an incredible amount of money for a high-powered attorney. You're using a public defender. The public defender kind of came on late and didn't have a lot of time to prepare. But essentially, in my view, they are not providing evidence of what they have. And for all we know, they could very easily just get her fingerprints from somewhere, put it on a gun, and try to frame or railroad your sister.
Yeah. Yeah, I like I said, from the very beginning, they've tried to discredit this movement and create this narrative that we are violent. And I believe to make sure that, you know, our voice is not heard. And they've also targeted people such as Amy Goodman and others, Red Fawn, and trying to discourage others from being active and activists and trying to fight for, you know, protection of clean water. So what our younger sister has done is created a generosity account, trying to raise funds so that we can get a private attorney and also a private investigator. And it's just, you know, the funds. One, I think what really hurt was when the state said the charges were dropped. A lot of people thought that this has gone away, everything's fine, she's been released. And I believe that was strategic to make sure that we lost momentum, because there was a lot of momentum building in this, because people saw the video, they knew that she was innocent, they felt that she was being targeted because of our family history, and that they wanted to discredit her and destroy that momentum. And like I said, they've been, well, they'll wake her up and they'll say, okay, you have court today, and the family doesn't know, so we're not able to be there in the courtroom and support her, and she's there all alone. So we, as a family, we're going everywhere we can, just trying to raise funds for her legal fund and also, you know, bring awareness. So if you go to the generosity account for Red Fawn, you can donate to just everything that we're working towards, the advocacy, the attorney, just, you know, supporting her right now. And then also the freeredfawn.com site. We're selling t-shirts. I mean, it's really kind of like a very grassroots thing that we're doing, but we're doing everything that we can to try to raise funds for legal court and awareness.
How do people donate to the generosity account?
So if they go into generosityaccount.com, the generosity.fundraising.com, and the put Red Fawn, or you can just go to the Free Red Fawn account and then freeredfawn.com, and it has all the links there. I think even if people can donate like a couple dollars, it makes a huge difference collectively. So it doesn't matter if you don't have a lot of money, and it's, you know, our life, my sister's life. And it's unfortunate that because of the lack of our financial resources, that she's going to end up having to pay for this with her life. You know, a minimum of 10 years is, it's terrifying. And like I said, she's remained strong during this process and positive, and she knows, she, you know, says just continue to pray, because just have sending that positive energy. And she said, I'm innocent, just pray, just know that I have faith that, you know, everything will work out, and this is what I was meant to do in my life, and bringing awareness to the protection of clean water. But as a family member, I'm just working to, you know, relentlessly to try to bring awareness and raise funds, because this is her life.
And that's freereddawn.com? Freereddawn.com. So I'm going to say a few things that she probably doesn't feel comfortable saying, because as you know, I keep it real. If I'm up for murder charges, I don't want a public attorney. I want a private attorney. I want the best attorney money could buy. It's no knock on the attorney currently. I don't know him or her. But when you're up against corrupt politicians, when you're up against corrupt oil companies, when you're up against a machine, which is North Dakota, which has shown day in and day out that they are creating charges out of thin air to pretty much silence peaceful protesters. And they're doing it to protect an oil pipeline. Let's remember what this is about. The public police have been protecting a private oil company. They're doing it in North Dakota. They're doing it in Illinois. They have barricades around the construction for DAPL in Illinois. Same thing in Iowa. So when she's asking you for money, she's doing it very nicely, this and that. Everybody has their own situation, but if Red Fawn has a chance, she's going to need the best legal team and investigators money could buy. So that's Red Fawn, freeredfawn.com. Secondly, again, in this age, we've seen a lot of cases, particularly with young African-Americans killed senselessly by police that would have been swept under the rug with, if not for the video. There is video in this case. And like she said, there was momentum for her sister, but the police department probably strategically said the charges were dropped to stop that momentum. So go to youtube.com, click Red Fawn arrest, look at this video. If you could find her shooting at a police officer, show it to me, because I've watched it probably 30 times. I can't see a damn thing other than a young 37-year-old woman buried on the ground with seven police goons on top of her. That video needs to get out there, as does awareness, because the only way you light a fire under the judge's ass or under the new governor's ass there or under, I don't want to go with President Trump because that's a stretch. The bottom line is the only chance you have is a very, very experienced expert representation, investigators, and an army of grassroots organization behind you. Her sister is a medic, was doing a lot to help the camp. And as far as I could see, there has been no public pronouncement that they have found a gun with her fingerprints in it on it. And in a case where you're charging someone with attempted murder of a police officer, she's saying minimum of 10 years. I'm being real. If they find her guilty, she's going away for a lot longer than 10 years. I'm sorry to say that, but that's just the truth. So I also want to put into the context of, you know, I'm covering a lot of different things, but Standing Rock, it's not like all the human rights abuses have gone away. I've been trying as best as I can to update on my Facebook page. Just yesterday, there were more mace sprayed at unarmed people on a bridge for the crime of putting up a teepee on a bridge that has been blocked for 4 or 5 months now, blocking traffic, blocking emergency vehicles. Two days before that, they arrested between 6 and 10 unarmed water protectors for praying, a prayer walk, where they tear gassed people. They shot rubber bullets at people. This isn't like 2 months ago. This is this week. So there's still human rights abuses going on. So it's not just her sister who's unfortunately been in prison for 3 months. It's right now. There's people probably watching right now who are water protectors that are facing jury trials early this year for they've been charged with felonies again for trespassing while praying. This is not in Africa, folks. This is in the U.S., United States of America. So there's only so much I could do. There's only so much Red Dawn here could do. You got to raise awareness. You got to share the video. You got to donate if you can. If you're a lawyer and want to help pro bono with research, with investigation, we'll put up after this on YouTube all the information. She's doing everything she can. I know you've driven probably at this point 50, 60, 70 hours to and from court. The reason I'm passionate about this is, you know, bottom line is if your sister was guilty, she's guilty. But in my view, as a journalist, if you haven't proved it, if there's video evidence that puts serious doubt on that, and also let's not forget, they haven't exactly been kind to her in prison. They kept her without her glasses until recently, correct?
It was about several weeks ago. They gave her glasses when she was arrested that had been broken. So they've had them that whole time, and they finally gave them to her because she was getting migraines.
Yeah. So they wouldn't give her glasses. Does that sound like justice to you? And like that might sound like nothing, like, you know, oh, they didn't give her glasses. It's not like she didn't eat. Well, if I'm imprisoned and I don't have my glasses, I can't see without glasses. That's psychological torture. So the bottom line is, folks, the reason I wanted to talk to you today is to keep this in the conversation. The court case is less than, it's under 2 months from now. Again, they don't have private representation. They have a public defender. Again, she was pinned down by 7 police officers. So it's up to you. I could do so much. You could do so much. But you know what? If you live in or around North Dakota, what prison is she at?
She is at Stetson County in Jamestown, North Dakota.
Stetson County in Jamestown, North Dakota. So I'm a journalist. I'm not going to organize a protest for you, but Stetson County, Jamestown Prison, now you know where she's staying. You know who the there's a new governor. You know where the state capitol is if you've been a water protector. You could lobby President Trump if you want, but show us the evidence that her sister, has your sister ever been convicted of trying to shoot anyone or anything like that before?
No, she has not.
Does she have a criminal record of violence?
She went down there just to commit her life to protecting clean water and helping people. And she was pretty much on a pilgrimage, just going there. And she was planning on going there and then also helping, you know, our brothers and sisters, our relatives at Oak Flats in Superior, Arizona, and then going to Oklahoma and just going different places.
It's on you. Share the video if you want. FreeRedFawn.com. There's links to donate to the generosity account. And one last thing, if you want to say.
Please just go to
as loud as you.
Go to FreeRedFawn.com. Learn about the case. You know, donate to their legal fund if you're able to. But just pray. Continue to pray and send our positive energy, because that is a lot. That means a lot. And I think that collectively we can bring justice to her and our family.
Thanks for talking to us again. I appreciate it.